My topic is retrospective multifactorial study of pediatric infectious and non-infectious keratitis in South India. To begin with, infectious keratitis is one of the leading causes of monocular blindness in the world. Non-infective causes of corneal blindness include vitamin A deficiency, chemical burn, native and traditional medications. Incidentally, these are the common causes of corneal blindness in the children. Due to difficulty in clinical examination, microbiology sample collection, and lack of adherence to treatment protocols, keratitis has detrimental outcome in pediatric population. Keratitis can lead to scar formation even after good therapeutic success, which can be a potential cause of developing sensory amblyopia in children. Predisposing factors may vary with geographical locations. Trauma accounts for 48% to 65% of all corneal ulcers in developing countries. However, the major risk factor in Western countries seem to be the use of contact lenses. Aim and objective of my study is to determine the etiological agents, predisposing factors, time lag of presentation, clinical features, microbiological profile, treatment protocol, time required for resolution of ulcer, and outcome in terms of structural outcome and visual acuity of infective and non-infective keratitis in children. Materials and methods. This is a retrospective study of 345 patients conducted between time period of January 2018 to December 2019. The records of patient 16 year old or less diagnosed with infectious and non-infectious keratitis were reviewed to assess the visual acuity, demographic data, predisposing factors, clinical course, microbiological culture results, treatment, structural outcomes and visual outcomes. Corneal scrapings were obtained under topical anesthesia or general anesthesia. Microbiological evaluation included scrapings for smear followed by subsequent sequential scraping for culture plating, either in blood agar or potato dextrose agar. If the ulcers are clinically suspected to be caused by unusual organisms such as nocardia or acanth amoeba, or if the smear results were positive for these organisms, additional relevant culture media were used. Eyes were treated initially based on clinical evaluation and microbiological smear examination. The treatment was then modified according to the culture. Inclusion criteria of my study is patients of age less than 16 years diagnosed with infectious and non-infectious keratitis. Looking at the results, presentation lag means time required between occurrence of symptoms and presentation to the hospital. It was found that maximum patients came between 1 to 5 days of occurrence of symptoms, followed by 5 to 15 days. Very few patients came within a day, that is 24 hours of occurrence of symptoms. Around 33.2% of diagnosed keratitis were of infective etiologies and the rest were of non-infectious etiology. Looking at the risk factor, majority of them had no associated risk factors. The trauma was found to be most common risk factor, followed by previous history of surgery, followed by systemic comorbidities like vitamin A deficiency, history of chickenpox. Some of the older children had contact lens induced keratitis. Few had associated vernal keratoconjunctivitis, exposure keratopathy due to Bell's palsy and other causes. Among trauma, stick trauma and dust trauma were most common. Fingernail injury and trauma by toy were also common. Among chemical trauma, Fevicol was found to be the most common, followed by Modar juice trauma. Among the clinical features, subepithelial keratitis and stromal keratitis were more common. Very few patients presented with corneal melt and rarely progressed to corneal perforation. Looking at the smear positive keratitis, fungal filaments were found to be the majority, followed by Microsporidium and gram positive cocci. Few smears showed presence of polymorphonuclear leukocytes. Among the culture positive, Pythium, Pseudosporidium, Nocardia were more common. Other organisms found were Fusarium, Aspergillus, and Staphylococcus. In this study, viral keratitis was found to be the most common. Bacterial keratitis and fungal keratitis followed viral keratitis. Marginal keratitis was also common. Rarely there was acanth amoeba and pythium keratitis. Among the non-infectious, nutritional and chemical keratitis was most common. Adenoviral keratoconjunctivitis and microsporidial keratitis was also found. Majority of the patient healed with only medical treatment. Few required glue with bandage contact lens. Very few required amniotic membrane grafting and total penetrating keratoplasty. Rarely patch grafting was done. Majority of the patient healed with scar formation. Few patients had no scar formation. Very few patients had corneal thinning and graft infection. Majority of the ulcers healed in a week. This study shows viral keratitis as major cause for pediatric keratitis followed by bacterial and fungal keratitis. Among non-infectious etiology, majority were nutritional keratopathy and chemical keratopathy. This study shows maximum of patients respond to medical treatment alone and rarely glue with bandage contact lenses. Total penetrating keratoplasty, amniotic membrane grafting or patch grafting is required. Delay in treatment was found to be more associated with scarring, although early treatment does not necessarily prevent scarring. This study shows that it took 10 to 16 days of the ulcer to resolve in majority of the patient. Final visual acuity better than 6/12 were 80.3% patient who presented early, that is within 5 days. While patient who presented late, that is more than after 2 weeks, the final visual acuity, that is better than 6/12, was found to be only in 63% of the patients. Conclusion of my study: infectious keratitis is more common than non-infectious keratitis in pediatric population. Early diagnosis, treatment and follow-up leads to better structural and visual outcome. Medical treatment can be initiated depending upon clinical features and modified depending upon culture result instead of waiting for laboratory results to initiate the treatment. Patients should be closely followed as some ulcers can lead to corneal melt and perforation. These are my references. Thank you.